Hey guys, I've got a job.
Really? What's your job?
I get graphics cards and I put them in a machine and I press the play button. Yeah.
Wow, that sounds like a pretty easy job. I mean, how much money do you make?
Make about $7 a day per well, $4 a cow.
Dude, are you okay? You're having a bit of a breakdown here.
Oh, I just can't get my money back in 100 days. It's gonna take me 200 days now.
Nvidia said that the RTX 3060 is going to be coming in from $329. Now, we all know with the current situation that that is going to be a far cry from what it really is going to cost out there on the market. So today's review is going to be just like the very similar review that I did on the RTX 3080 Colorful that came through here a week ago, and that is that crypto miners are ruining the prices of everything right now. Because honestly, when I looked at the 3060 Ti and the 3070, when I first reviewed them, you could buy them and they were coming in at decent prices. In Australia, you could get a 3060 Ti when it just came out for $700 Aussie, and that was just above what Nvidia said it would come out in Australia for. But with the current situation in Bitcoin and Ethereum and the prices going through the roof, this card right here does offer some kind of glimmer of hope in that Nvidia did promise that they would nerf crypto algorithms on these graphics cards in particular. Now, when I put this to the test here at the studio, I used nicehash and I enabled all the different miners that they could enable, and we'll get this elephant out of the room, just we'll kick him out of the room right now because I want to get onto the gaming performance for a gaming graphics card. But it's important to know that I don't think miners are going to be desiring this card as much as they would the other ones, say for instance the 3060 Ti, which as it stands to this date, the 3060 Ti is the best not only price performance but power efficiency graphics card for mining. So that's going to be very desirable for miners, where they can earn up to $8 a day on that thing or even more, as opposed to this. When I put this through nicehash, it was earning up to around $4 a day. That was the maximum profit it could pull. Now I did get, I had someone who sent me a leaked screenshot a while ago about the 3060 mining rate and how it was nerfed in Ethereum mining, and that was true. But then there was some other videos that surfaced where this thing could make $7 a day, and I don't know where they got those $7 a day figures from, because I tested it here with all those algorithms and the best algorithm for it was like Octopus or something, where the cryptocurrency mining rates, I still believe on these other algorithms, are being pushed down and nerfed, just not as hard as they would on Ethereum. But the thing is, Ethereum's making the most money. So when you push down that Ethereum algorithm, then that's the profits that are sinking for people who want to pick this up for a mining graphics card. And so what this means is that this card right here, the RTX 3060, should be going into the hands of gamers more than it would into the hands of miners. And why this is that those miners will want to buy up all those 3060 Ti's still and 3070s, and they won't focus as hard on this card as they will on the others. And so this card right here will still suffer from a higher price. I just don't think it will see as high a price as the others, like the 3060 Ti, for example, and especially the 3080, where the problem with the 3080 is I haven't even seen it in stock anywhere. That thing's been backordered for literally like months and months, where they're just trying to fill the back orders. And of course, you've got all these greedy miners in the queue trying to get as many of those as they can too. So this card right here does offer straight away a glimmer of hope for gamers. Now, as I said, I'm praying for a cryptocurrency crash, and if that happens, we can just forget this whole intro ever existed. However, it's finally time to get into the meat potatoes, and I'll even throw in some sausages in for you guys in today's review, where we've got the 12 gigabytes of VRAM on this card in particular. It's an interesting configuration because I know a lot of people out there are thinking the same thing that I was thinking, as why 12 gigabytes when the 3060 Ti and 3070 are 8 and the 3080 is 10? You've got more VRAM on this card than you do on the like sister flagship card, the 3080. And I asked Nvidia directly, what is the reason for this? And they told me straight up, they said with the configuration of the 192-bit bus, they could only either put 6 gigabytes on or 12 gigabytes. So they opted to go with 12 gigabytes. Even though it's fine today, it might not be enough in say a year's time. So they did put the 12 gigabytes in there just to be a bit more conservative. But in terms of the GPU silicon itself, you've got less CUDA cores and you've got a smaller die in general than the likes of the bigger 3060 Ti and 3070, for example. So it is a new card, so to speak, in its own right. Now, going through the performance figures, you're like, how does this thing perform? Let's pull up those numbers for you guys where I tested 1440p and also 4K numbers here to give you guys an idea of how this thing will perform. And you can see from these numbers, it's roughly about half that of an RTX 3080. It does still beat out some of those previous generation cards comfortably. And I mean, look, in due time, if a crypto crash comes and prices return to normal, at $330, if you can pick up one of these for around that in the future, then it's going to offer very good value for money. And when we look at the 3080 and what that was offering around MSRP, I mean, albeit you couldn't really get one, that was giving good price performance in its own right as well. But you may notice up until this point, there are two graphics cards here on the table, and one is the Eagle and one is the Gaming OC, both from Gigabyte. And so there is no Founders Edition with this model, as opposed to the 3060 Ti and upwards. But what Gigabyte sent out here was the Eagle, which is apparently their entry level RTX 3060. And then they've got the Gaming OC, which offers a bigger cooler as well as supposedly more performance. But as we can see with these graphs, the performance isn't really anything different from the Eagle. And I was kind of surprised here. I even reinstalled the drivers, just checking and scratching my head. But sure enough, the Eagle and the Gaming OC RTX 3060s were performing virtually identical, though where they do differ, and I will pull up this next graph for you guys, is the temperatures and noise. The Eagle did surprisingly well, but it looks like Gigabyte are sort of limiting the fan speeds from going really loud and really fast, and they're just putting an artificial cap that says 100%, when I do believe they could spin faster, but they're doing this to keep the noise down. So this card out of the box goes up to 90% fan speeds. That's for the Eagle in a 28C environment, and the temperatures were mediocre. The noise was actually very good, but if we step over to the Gaming OC, if you're paying a bit more money for the Gaming OC versus the Eagle, this is where you're going to see a big difference, where the Gaming OC was basically whisper quiet, even at 80% fan speeds, and the temperatures were actually pretty solid. Though in terms of overclocking, they both overclocked to virtually the same levels, an extra 120 so megahertz on the Eagle, an extra 130 megahertz on the Gaming OC, and the memory overclocked also pretty nicely to around 1,000 megahertz on both. Though the undervolting is the real champion here, where when I tested the undervolts, we were dropping power consumption by about 80 watts, which made this system, even with a 10900K, 32 gig of RAM and all the other perks, this was using up 250 watts while we were gaming. So the power consumption on this card is ridiculously good, especially if you want to undervolt it. And on the Eagle in particular, since the performance of the cooling is mediocre, undervolting this will then make a mediocre cooler look like it's doing a fantastic job. So undervolting on this model in particular, can highly recommend it. Overclocking and out of the box performance, it's decent, but undervolting is definitely where it is at. The move over with both these cards, they are more lightweight in particular, where they're both coming under 1 kilogram. Looking on the back of the inputs and outputs on both, we have HDMI 2.1. We've got two of those, and then two DisplayPort 1.4a outs. So if you do want to hook these up to a 120 hertz 4K screen, but if you're spending all that money on a 4K OLED, you might want to get the RTX 3080 or a 6800 XT, but then you go online, you check the prices, scalpers, we're not going to go there. But the final things to go over is the aesthetics, where you've got a little bit of RGB. They make a note of RGB Fusion 2.0 on the box, but on the Eagle, it's literally like a line, and then on the OC, it's just a logo. So there's nothing to get excited about with the RGB on these cards. We've got more of a gunmetal gray black aesthetic on the Gaming OC with 380mm fans, and then on the Eagle, 2 100mm fans, and a more of a darker gray, dark gray transparent over the Eagle logo. Then you've got a plastic backplate on both of these cards with the flow-through design on the coolers. And I'm gonna say one thing. I've noticed with these flow-through designs that they've been implementing on these cards in particular, yes, it's gonna blow a little bit of hot air towards your RAM, but in general, I've found the coolers do perform that little bit better with this opening here to allow that air to pass through directly, especially if you've got good airflow on your case. The cards and the cooler designs like this are gonna appreciate that little bit of extra airflow through your case. Anyhow, guys, it's now conclusion time, and I'm gonna say straight up, this is the first time I've reviewed a graphics card on launch where it's been launched into such a messy market. Things have just gotten worse since the end of 2020, where crypto demand has made a launch like this just very uneasy on everyone in general. I think you've got tension everywhere. I mean, I've made videos and there's just people arguing in the comments, and then I go to other videos and I check the comments there and people are frustrated. And they're frustrated because of the fact that there's just not enough supply, and now we've got this massive pent-up demand coming in from miners. And unfortunately, in regards to the miners, they're prepared to pay more, I think, for these cards than the gamers. And so that's leaving gamers now scratching their heads with sort of value that's been all messed up. And the reason that value is all messed up now is because even the older generation cards at their MSRP are probably looking like they're a better buy even back when they bought those cards than the cards that are on the market now for the available prices. So this basically leaves me with the recommendation of, if you can find one of these cards for close to that $330 MSRP, even close to $400, in the current climate, it's going to be a good buy. But you may have to go onto some of these websites where they're doing the raffle system, where you enter into the raffle to get the chance to buy one and not get ripped off. And so I'd like to see more retailers sort of partaking in this practice, where it does help get these cards into hands of gamers. And in terms of the cryptocurrency algorithm thing, I mean, everyone's got different opinions on that. My opinion is that if Nvidia does have poor yielding silicon and in turn push out some of the demand that would otherwise be snapping up gaming cards to miners that wouldn't affect gaming graphics card stock, then that's a good thing. And so nerfing the cryptocurrency algorithm on this sort of does make a little bit of a statement that they do want to get these into hands of gamers. And yes, guys, I get it. Nvidia doesn't care about you. A corporation doesn't care about you. But one thing they will care about, and same with AMD and Intel, they will care about your business. And that's one thing Nvidia do want to do, is they do want to care about your long-term business. They want to make you a loyal customer, so when they're releasing graphics cards in the future, you're buying them as well. So people that seem to think that this whole thing is marred with conspiracy, I don't think there's much conspiracy here. I think they want to keep the gamers buying their graphics cards because they know the cryptocurrency miners aren't a consistent buyer base as opposed to the gamers. Anyhow, guys, I hope you enjoyed today's review. If you did, then be sure to hit that like button for us. Let us know in the comments section below what you think of the RTX 3060, its performance, as well as this whole situation right now. I know it's all messed up. It's just like one of these things where I'm also sending these cards back to Gigabyte too. I don't get to keep them. That's how bad the stock problems are. So, I mean, I'm just happy to take a look at this thing and give you guys a video. So I hope you enjoyed this one. And we've got the question of the day here, which comes from Gamer Dad Reviews. And they ask, hi, Brian, thanks for this review. The 3080 looks boss, but GG trying to snap one up. So this was from our 3080 video. He says, can you advise me, please? I just picked up a new LG CX55 OLED. Do you think it's worth trying to flip my existing OG RTX 2080 for an RTX 3070 or 3080 to make use of that sweet HDMI 2.1? Or should I just sit this gen out and skip to RTX 3000 whenever that drops? Thanks for another great vid, my man. Cheers. Thanks for the question. And to answer that directly, you definitely will want to get, if you've got the LG 55 inch CX, you want to unlock that HDMI 2.1 port so you can get 120 hertz 4K OLED. It looks absolutely gorgeous, but you also get to unlock the true RGB color, or the 444 color, even at 10 bit. And so those two things alone definitely make it worthwhile an upgrade as opposed to sticking with the RTX 2080. So what I'd recommend doing in this current market, if you can, try and find someone that's got an RTX 3070 and maybe they're just thinking about selling it or something like that, and maybe put an ad up where you offer to swap that and cash their way. So they get an RTX 2080 and they might have a bit of extra cash in their pocket, and then you get the RTX 3070, because selling your card and then trying to get one on the market might be a bit messy. But there are some people who generally just want to swap and they need a bit of extra money, and they might not need a 3070 and they'll be happy with a 2080. So that'd be my advice. If you can do that, you won't lose too much money, and you'll also be sort of getting a decent price for your 2080 in the process. Hope that answers that question. And with that aside, if you guys have stayed this far and you're enjoying that tech yes content, be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and I'll catch you in another one very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.